This is Thursday, March 9th, 2017. The Board of Directors of Northampton Council on Aging and Senior Services meeting is in effect. We have a public session. Is there any members of the public? So we'll go on to approval of minutes. Or do you want to make a motion?
I'll make a motion to accept minutes as read.
Okay, Teresa, you're second. Okay, any problems, additions, or questions with the minutes?
Anybody need a copy of the minutes? Anybody need a copy of the agenda?
I know it gets mailed out, but I won't get it until today.
I know. If there's something on that one.
Okay. Are there any questions or additions, subtractions, whatever, for other minutes? All those in favor of approving them?
Aye.
Anyone opposed? No. The minutes have been approved. Okay, move on to finances. Budget review. I'd rather to do it in place here.
Okay, it's a surprise, but okay. I'm not telling. Okay, I'm going to pass these out. This is the budget that I submitted. This is the draft budget that I submitted to. You can just take and pass it on. this is what I passed. I just submitted to the treasurer, the finance officer at the Gazette. Oh, sure. There's two pages.
Yeah. Oh, there's two pages.
Maybe I can do this a little bit more systematically. It's like breaking it up a little bit. There's two pages. Excuse me. Let me. I'll just keep on.
You were always well organized. I want you to
no, actually, it was Jen very nicely showed me how to get a nice elongated page because I kept trying on my computer and I couldn't do it. But I found out we have another.
Oh, I just have that.
Okay.
I'm sorry. Anyway, there is
a really nice printer that does the very nice thing, but she had to tell me like within 10 minutes ago, so I'm sorry for the confusion. Okay, so here's the first page, if you could pass it out, and here's the second page.
Thank you.
You need the second page?
We have a front page. The toys.
Which page do you need?
Second. That's all right.
Yeah.
It's a two-front page.
Page two.
No. No, the other
just take one. Just take
this is all front page.
This is all one of these.
And the second page is coming.
Linda?
Yes.
Do you have another agenda?
Right.
Take one of
these. Sorry.
Okay, everybody all set? Anybody with any extras?
Yeah, there's extras here. I'm just going to get them all the extras together.
Oh.
This is like exactly.
I guess I only have one extra. I need to get a second page.
You've got the same thing.
The second page is like this, John.
Okay, we don't got
that.
You got
I have two.
John needs page a second page. John needs a page two.
Page two.
John needs page two.
I need page two.
That's page one.
I don't need that one.
I need page two.
Okay, this will probably,
we'll
I will
share.
Never, yeah, just share, please,
share.
Because it's not, it's only a draft, and if you have any
that's two.
So from my perspective as a person who's been doing budgeting for 40 years, this is a different kind of budget. The city has a different kind of budget than what I'm used to. I'm used to something, you know, like, you know, this is where all of the resources, and this is the cost, and, you know, we identify all the costs. But, you know, I mean, we're kind of lucky because the city pays for Bob's salary, they pay for the upkeep of the building, and, you know, so a lot of the normal expenses that you have when you have a leadership hat on are not really part of this budget, so it's kind of good. And there is going to be a revision to this. When I go to the mayor, which will be by the end of this, it will be by the end of March, I'll also have an amendment which will include the cost of the vans. And the staff, well, the staff of the vans are actually included in this budget, but anyway, it will go in, all of the van expenses will be brought forward. And so.
Can I ask a question? This says prepared January 2016.
Yeah, just like last year's budget.
It's got Patty Shaughnessy, Joanne Borges.
This isn't this year at all.
Okay.
This is all last year.
Did I wonder if I got the wrong budget here.
I think you printed, yeah.
Oh, shoot. Yes. I'm not going to say what I really want to say right now. Oh, my gosh. Yes. All right, you know what I will do, everybody? I'm going to the mayor at the end of March. Stop laughing, please. This is not funny. This is totally unprofessional.
You've never made a mistake.
About this.
So should we pass it off?
You can throw darts at it if you want.
I think it should be shredded.
Yeah, I think so too. I think we ought to send it back.
Thank you.
Send it back and we'll shred them.
So that's all right. That's what happens when you do something 10 minutes before you're supposed to be at this table. That's why he gave me the book. Anyway, what I will do is I will actually bring you the real approved budget at our next meeting with the increases of cost associated to the van drivers and the van upkeep and the gas. You know, it's pretty similar, pretty obviously, it's pretty similar to the budget that you're looking at right now, except there is a cost of living a raise, and, you know, the budget, the unions also appropriated a certain increase in budget in salaries. So, but we're still really good, we're still in really good shape, at least for one more year, so let's see what happens. But so, please accept my apology. I can't believe I did that. But anyway, life happens. Thank you, Marlene, for, you know, making me feel. But, you know, we were
sorry.
No,
I was going to say next. So.
Okay. Who else wants to say next?
If she didn't find it, one of us would have.
Yeah, I am really sorry about that. Okay, on to the next goof. Anyway, sorry about that. And so next week, the next meeting, I'll bring the real budget that is actually approved. Okay.
Now, can we go on to the director's report?
Oh yeah, that's yes.
Maybe Frank could get it. You want people to print it?
I don't think it's really not that much.
Let's wait for the real thing.
Yeah. Why don't we wait until we actually have it approved and everything? But thank you, Linda. That was a good idea.
Yeah.
Okay. It was just. It was 1:15, I was sitting down and saying, oh, budget, well, maybe I'll just show what I submitted, and, you know, anyway, that didn't work. Okay, so we've got a lot of good things happening, and again, I feel like most of the old and new business really does reflect the director's report. So I'll tell you a couple things that are not on here, and next Friday, we're going to have a number of, like, I think about 6 or 7 different Council on Aging directors to come here by our invitation to think about how we can regionalize some of our activities, like walking club, and competitive sports, and a few other things to, you know, really utilize the resources that we have in the whole county. I've been talking to a number of directors, and they're very excited about this prospect. And so we'll see what happens, and that will be on your next agenda, and we'll give you an update on that. Another thing, it is on here, the urn is under new business. but I think I'm going to tell you this anyway, is that we did get recognized for a community block grant, but not recognized. We have to defend the community block grant next week. And so a number of people from EARN who are on the committee, this is, again, EARN is the Employment After Retirement Network. And so we've been doing a lot of hard work, and the proposal's really good. And anybody who would like to see it, I gladly send you a call. Maybe we'll bring it to the next meeting, and you can have a chance to review it. But, you know, the bottom line is that there's a whole lot of people within this community that really need to supplement their income. And I think that that's a service that it will be really important for us to present. And there's other organizations such as the Franklin County, Hampshire Franklin Career Center, and but they don't necessarily reach the population that we reach. But
Linda, could you link up with them?
Yeah. We have, and they're very. Yeah, they're very cooperative. Yeah, and then we just found out that there's another initiative nationally, and it's called ReServe. And so my thought is that we could, represent ourselves locally, connect with Hampshire and Franklin County Career Center when we're talking about job skills building, and also their job bank is really interesting and pretty complete as far as what kind of employment opportunities are out there. So anyway, we have a whole group of people working. They're going to be attending the mayor's the mayor isn't going to be on this committee, but there's a number of city councilors that are on the committee that will be going to go with as a group defending this as an important service. The money that we're asking for is for just a part-time 10-hour a week consultant, and it's a one year position, just because we're going to have to be there's a lot that has to be done, and there's no one on our staff right now that could do some of those T-crossing that needs to happen. So we'll see what happens, and it's kind of a new thing, and it's called bridge employment. It's a new phenomena, and as we were designing the grant, we identified that that it's actually out there. It wasn't just the last 10 people coming to say, so do you know anything about jobs, Linda? But it is actually happening all over the United States right now for a number of reasons. That basically your retirement is not enough in many, many cases. So I'll keep you informed. I'll tell you how grant defending things happen next week.
Since this is a grant that is finite, are there any plans in terms of if you get it, how it's going to be continued on and stuff?
Yeah. The committees themselves are going to have a lot of autonomy. Okay. There'll be a group that will be the ones that will be going to Smith College and Mount Holyoke, and just saying that this is a new way to look at retirement and really educate the people. But this is a need out there, and since we've applied for this, I have seen two other grants that have come across my desk with this. Okay. And usually what happens when I do grant writing is, when the idea is really right and it really reflects the demographic, growth of that, when we usually start off with a really small amount, it comes. You will build it, they will come. And that it always happened that way.
For the funding.
So we'll see what happens.
Okay.
The people that are our members, we have now about 20 people, and all of them have a pretty significant role in the development of the group too. So we could be autonomous. We could.
Okay.
Good. We'll see what happens. Mm-hmm. Our fingers crossed, though. Feels good.
Any other questions on that?
Anybody? Thoughts?
Okay, we'll move on to old business. Oh, no.
Yeah,
we have
more. Okay. More that aren't on there. another thing, and I know that this has been in some of your minds, we just talked regarding the staff at our last meeting, and we are thinking about the extended hours. And I know we've always, we've wanted it. A number of our people who are members have asked for it. We thought we'd start slowly, and we're thinking the 1st of June might be a good time to begin. And so the extended hours would be just to 8 to 5, because it's a slow move. But, you know, it still satisfies a few of the people that like to use the fitness center at 8 o'clock and, you know, and want to maybe extend it a little bit. And the other thing, it's also going to give us an opportunity to add, you know, at least maybe a whole hour more of activities that have actually been shut off at 4 o'clock. And it's coming to a point where we really do need to think that, you know, like you all had that space talk and walk, yes, the last time. Well, so if we extend hours and we think our space, you know, we should be able to meet most of the needs that were, that are the activities that are being addressed now.
How does that affect the staff? Like the longer days or different shifts?
They're just so abused, man. That's why I did not bring it up to you first before I brought it up to the staff. But the staff actually do a very staggered hourly thing, and they thought that it really wouldn't be a problem. And Heather, you can respond to that, your thoughts.
We're kind of here anyway, till 5 mostly, so.
But that will make you here later. You're here till 5 because it closes at 4:30. Now, if it closes at 5, you're here till 5:30.
I think we all need to sit and talk and figure out, you know, maybe someone's going to come in at 9. Yeah. We're not trying to milk more hours out of staff, I promise you, because we already have enough.
Just don't do burnout.
We also have the support of building monitors and that kind of thing too. So I think an extra hour isn't going to be big. It's going to be once we start looking at
Just organizing
Like you said, it's baby steps. It's only a beginning.
Exactly.
But people are going to want more than 5 o'clock.
And you also thought ahead to Saturday hours.
Yep,
that's the next thing to look at.
Well, Craig will cover it.
Well, I believe we had a survey.
Well, it would be big because most people still work.
And Saturday hours was the most thing that people wanted more.
87%. 87% of the people wanted Saturday hours.
They didn't want to go to 8 o'clock at night. They wanted to have Saturday hours. So we're moving.
We're almost at full capacity of staff. I think that, you know, that's something that we can work on. And, you know, again, with the support of the staff, I understand completely what you're saying. And, you know, I think all of us can remember those times that maybe we worked 6 days a week and, you know, it wasn't nice. It's never nice to work 6 days a week, and I would never ask anyone to do that, but, you know. Easthampton, I think, has Saturday.
Is that right?
Yes, I'm sure so. On the door, they have Saturday hours.
Okay. Yeah, Department of Labor's put a lot of rules in. There's a lot of new laws about that. Against 6 hours, over 40 hours, some 37 and a half. Read the Department of Labor laws, they are amazing. Yeah, they've really, really stepped them up.
Okay, we'll take that into consideration, but, you know, that's why first step is so much easier, because there's never a time that I ever leave before 5:30, and, you know, it just works out that way. And it's only meaning sometimes it means we would have to maybe cover the desk a little bit longer or something, you know, while the volunteers are, you know, again, I think it's going to work, and it'll be our first step, baby step.
Anything else?
All right. So last night we had we have this thing called Group Sing, and it's once a month, and it's in the auditorium. Mm-hmm. Well, we actually had it at the group practitioners last night, And it was really absolutely lovely. Yeah, and James arranged it, you know. And everybody absolutely had an incredible time. And so, you know, sometimes the group thing goes well here, but it was really cool to change the venue. And every, are you waiting for us?
Well, I wasn't sure if you wanted me to let you know when I pulled around. So whenever you're ready.
Okay.
Just let me know.
How many people came?
It was the same approximately, but the whole pub was singing with us too, so that was kind of nice anyway.
And the bartender, I called the bartenders just a few minutes ago.
Yeah.
Talked to him, and he doubled his tip, so he was tickled to death. He said he had even had fun.
Is that where it was?
Yeah.
Yeah.
Win-win all the way around.
Yeah.
Which bar?
Right up in Florence.
A part of me feels that, I mean, I really do want to look at the services for older people to be, have a campus effect. And, you know, where we'll be doing some special programming with on genealogy with the library, you know, and we can do that. And so if we have a group sing at the local pub, it works. I'm sorry, it really works.
I'm surprised that they wanted to go to a pub.
Yes,
and they wanted to do it again.
And the pub.
Well, they did, I'm sure. I did.
Well, they made money, you know, there was somebody working on something. So they weren't teetotalers.
Because sometimes, you know, don't want to go out at night.
Well, it was early. It was only 5 to 7.
It's only an hour.
Yeah. But still, wow, that's great.
And many of the people stayed through open mic night. So it doubled the open mic audience too. So everybody across the board was tickled with it.
So it kind of morphed into open mic night.
Yeah. So part of me thinks that if we do some regionalized programming, we could, you know, extend it to the region, and we might have it, you know, go to a different place, you know, so we would have like a pub crawl, you know.
We're not going to use the van to bring the people home from the, I'm saying, are we that drive?
Not for that reason. No, they were really good. I really watched out. So it's something. And the other thing I was thinking, as we are going, we will be viewing the van. That's a surprise. And Jen has it pulled out in front, so you actually see it. The other thing I was thinking of, I don't know about you, but a lot of people have told me through the years, say, you know, it's really, I don't really want to be in a long-term relationship, but I want to go out with someone. I want to go to dinner with someone. Because, you know, sometimes you're a widow or a widower, and, you know, you have beautiful friends, but a lot of times you don't go out at night. Anyway, so I'm thinking of using the van for date night. And again, maybe regional. And we would ask, you know, local restaurants for, you know, on Tuesday nights, would you give us a 25% off if we could have, you know, go to the Eastside Grill, can you give, and, you know, you drop them off and pick them up. Anyway, so these are just thoughts I have. You know, we'll see what the other regional people think. And also, I really appreciate your input. But, you know, and our drivers are very, again, it's 19 and a half hours per driver. We will be adding one more driver. So there'll be enough time to do maybe a quick little trip once a month for a date night. Anyway.
Okay.
Any other
forget
questions?
Forget
Do it.
That's it for me right now.
Now we'll go to the update on the vans.
Okay. Can we go look at it now?
We could do that.
Or would you want to wait?
I want to wait till the end, because I got to shut the camera and turn it back.
Oh, yeah. Okay. So we're really excited. Jen has done a really outstanding job. And Michelle in supporting her to get this up and going, our first van. You know, when we first saw it, it was like, it's a little rickety, you know, okay, now we know why the PPTA gave us this van. But Jen we've got the emblem on, she got that going. All of the three new drivers have been going through three days of training. you know, most of them have every single credential you could possibly want, from CPR to, you know, every one of them. And so they're, I think they're going to be really exceptional. I think we're very lucky. And hopefully our third one, our second, that's a nice slip, but our third one. Our second van it's supposed to be coming. It was supposed to be coming in February. It's supposed to be coming now at the end of March. So, you know, we're on top of them almost at least weekly. And that's what they're telling us. That's what the secretary, when we call, is telling us. And that's going to be the really pretty one.
Well, when I was talking to Jen, who received the van from PBTA, she took one look at it, and the two front tires were practically bald. She brought it back to them and got two new tires.
Oh, good for her.
So there's no grass growing under her.
Good for her.
No, they've been on top of theirs.
And PBTA took the PBTA, and somebody took a white can of spray paint and just sprayed over it. So we had
Porcupine signs.
Put a sign on it for us. So
people are talking to me out in front saying, I'm so glad the van is finally here. I want to come more often, and now I'm going to come. And so, yeah, it feels really good. And I'm hoping beyond hope that, I mean, I really have no problem at all going back to city council and saying, okay, you know, our two vans are completely booked all the time. We need a third van, you know, and we'll see what happens. But from a logistic perspective, let's do two right now.
Linda, how long did it take to get this van?
That's the worst.
Was it years?
Yeah. Close to 2 years.
Yeah, it's been.
And we don't really have the one that we were, the one that everybody around the table worked so hard for, but that's coming.
That's coming.
Yeah.
Yeah, about 2 years ago, I took it over to have it lubed, and I put it up on the thing and said, it's all rotted out of it. Took it back and said, don't drive it. That was about 2 years ago.
I was thinking it was longer than that.
I thought it was longer. It seemed like it was longer.
Well, it was 2 years ago in the fall.
I don't remember that much longer. I've only been here 2 years.
Yeah. So I think it was 2 years in the fall. It just failed.
Wow.
But he was good service for 10, 12 years.
I just want to say a vote of confidence for Jennifer, because I've been a medical transportation person, and she is so organized and so thorough that I am so glad she's doing this. I am, because it's been a pleasure to work with her and drive people. It's just been, she makes it very easy and very organized. So
hopefully that'll
happen for these. I know this is going to be more complicated, but I think that she's the right person.
I'm afraid she's not sleeping too well. So I really want. I could say, give me anything. I'll do anything. I'll like wash the windows. I don't care, but just don't think that she has to do it. She and I'm in total agreement. She's an outstanding employee. We all of you guys are. We couldn't do what we have planned to do without the support of this great staff. Thank you, but I will share your kudos with her.
I tell her all the time.
Yeah.
You know, she sent us a little Valentine. Last year I was, you know, same thing. She sends the volunteers a little Valentine with a little, treat in it. You know, definitely, I think it's unnecessary, but she's really, very, very polite and very thankful.
We will share.
Yeah, having been a driver, I realize that organization at this end is very important.
Absolutely.
Yeah. Okay. Any questions on the vans? We'll see one later after the meeting's over. We'll go out and take a look at it. And St. Patrick's Day dinner.
Just a quick check-in. St. Patrick's Day dinner is on Saturday. I have Jim, Bob, and Marlene signed up as servers, so if you guys could be here for 5 o'clock. And I have Mary signed up just for coffee and all the little odds and ends, so she's coming at 4 o'clock. Is there anyone I've missed for? Okay, that would be great. Is there anyone that I've missed?
Well, you have John, who's doing everything.
I don't
You're all day.
John's not going home.
No, I know the kitchen is all set, so I don't even think about them. So thank you for that. Barbara, did you want to do a foreign savings bank table? Okay, so we'll make sure there's an FSB.
And we have a nice surprise, but that we can't make it official yet. because, anyway.
What a teaser you are.
I know, you have to wait until the next meeting.
It'll spill out soon, don't worry about it.
I know, I'm bad.
That's it, I think there's about 80 people who bought tickets so far. And I remember last year, we had people show up the day before wanting to get their tickets. So it's a capacity, 220 or something. We can put a lot of people in that room, according to the fire department.
That's 20, you better go buy some pizza.
20 extra people on the same day, that's scary.
It is good to give John a little heads up.
You're gonna have a cutoff.
I see, he can't run down to the store and get some.
No, once the tables, no, we don't sell tickets at the door. So once the tables are set up, whatever she decides is the final number, we'll stop selling tickets.
And we're still working, setting up tomorrow, right, at noon?
Yep, Kathy, Mary, and Victoria will set everything up tomorrow.
I can come after the chamber luncheon, if you want to. I can text you.
Mary only takes about an hour, and Mary kinda runs the show with that, so she's gonna tell Victoria what to do, so I think.
And tell me what to do.
What was it before?
Okay, thank you very much. Any questions on that? Hope everybody's got their tickets.
The national chain.
Staff vacancies.
Okay, we still just have a half a person to fill in. And that was what Jen's responsibilities were, you know, about a year, 2 years ago. And we still haven't filled it in, so right now, I just wanna make sure our van drivers are up and going, and the van's going. And so next week, we'll probably be posting that halftime person, and then we'll be on that.
And what is it, what's the position?
It was, it's just doing a lot of everything, you know, not, there's not, Jen would do the healthy food, she would do, you know.
Jen's original position was the fitness center coordinator and medical transportation coordinator. And then that person was 20 hours a week. And then when everyone started leaving the senior center, that's when she increased and was doing sort of the Mickey Mouse.
Oh, I think you know that. I thought you did the, you know, everything, jack of all trades kind of thing, Jane of all trades.
I mean, we all do that. So the half position is.
It evolved into it, yeah.
Oh, all right.
So the half position that's open is not doing the medical transportation, though she's still doing that.
She'll, no, yeah, all, everything with transportation is under Jen's hat. And then what we're doing is we're increasing the hours of our people in the fitness center to do a lot of what Jen used to do with the fitness center.
So the half-time position is available in the fitness center?
No, this will be doing, you know, just a real, a lot of everything, basically. You know, for instance.
Whoever's needed.
Yeah, exactly. Like, an example, Craig is working 19 and a half hours, 20 hours. Okay, and so they would be doing a lot of what you're doing on the other 20 hours a week. So that there'll always be someone up at the front desk, you know, doing all of the problem solving that always happens up there.
And Craig has already found out that he can fill in at the coffee shop.
Right.
I trained him one day, and they say he was filling in, so.
Yeah, that's helpful.
That's good to know.
And it's good to have somebody around who can.
Yeah, do that.
She did deals and things too, I think, right? Was it deals?
That's been through like four different staff members, so maybe we can all talk about that. Who gets to have it?
Jen actually still does all of that, and that's what, you know, it's just too much. And so she's still doing her halftime, everything, save the world kind of positions. And then she understands how complicated a transportation system is. And so I want to take away as much of that other stuff.
And I think that those of us who do the coffee shop in the afternoon sometimes, now we're sort of picking up things and learning new things to help out, so that's not a problem, it's the volunteers.
Yeah, everyone very nicely has decided that they'll help with the dishes, so I taught everyone how to do dishes.
Thank you.
Now, all those little pieces we can take off with Jen and our other staff, so we appreciate it.
It's really, it feels so much like a family here, it really is, it's really beautiful.
Okay, any questions on that? Yes, John?
I don't know, and I guess it's not here to say, but I just hope Jim's salary is more than the minimum wage now.
It is.
Because it was that way for a long time.
That's the successful part, getting more hours and the salary.
I don't know why those things happen, and it just doesn't feel good to me either. So, I mean, when I first realized that, you know, I was talking to everybody who talked to about that. Anyway, so no, it's a good salary, it's not a great salary, but, you know, that's
it's a good city salary.
Yeah, it's a good city salary.
And it's city, so.
Okay, but that was, thank you for being concerned about that.
Okay, want to move on to Highland Valley Elder Services?
Yeah, I did remember the meeting, and I did go to it, so that's a good sign. And, you know, they're doing well in terms of fiscally. They've got a lot of things going on, and there's new people coming into the organization, too. But, you know, it just continues to kind of go on and on, and looking at programs. They have a dementia program that they're working on. They got a grant for, so they're doing a lot of training with staff around dementia care. And they're actually hoping to get, this program called the Virtual Dementia Tour. And what it is that they have people who are trained, and they, people who kind of come into the tour are outfitted like what it would be like for somebody to have a dementing disease. So, so you get the whole figure, you know, sort of like walk in my shoes kind of thing, what it's like to have a dementing disease. So, you know, if we could talk to them even about having to come here and put it on, so if anybody from the community is interested in participating. So, I think I'm trying to think if there's anything outstanding. The lunch program, they're getting good kudos on their lunch program, et cetera. So, and new chefs and stuff. And people are really helpful. They started a new, and another up in Chester, they started a new program there for community dining. So that's working out well.
Any questions for Kathy?
Mm-hmm. We don't have people not eating in Northampton, do we?
Not that I know of.
At the meal sites, can people just walk into those, or do they have to be signed up with like the same program that's
I don't know, but meals? I can find out stuff like
someone
that.
Someone just asked me that.
Oh, okay.
I believe they have to call Highland Valley to get registered.
They do?
Yeah.
Okay.
I think it's
like
a
24-hour
notice or something.
Just to make sure the food is enough and stuff, I'm sure.
So John would
so the food
that.
Is better than
yeah, it is
because
I'll be crashing
and I've heard it's getting a little better. But you know what happens is you got commodities and it's what the government sends you and what you got. And I think some of the stuff's really try to make it a little more palatable. But
have you had a lunch at Monticello recently?
Not lately.
I've had it twice when I was on the board. Mm-hmm. They brought us on to Monticello and fed us lunch of what they
were right,
sending
yeah,
out that day. And it was good food.
Yeah.
Good tasting.
And they have to, really, they have to make do with what you got. And
yeah.
So I think that's the hard, you know, you need to have creative chefs and people who are able to kind of do that.
I've been having in the nutrition site director, the nutrition director of Highland Valley for a number of years. What the value of Highland Valley is that they cook their own meals. They don't contract out.
Yeah.
You know, that used to be an issue. And so cooking your own meals, and you know, if you contract out, you end up having it's more transport time and cooking.
Yeah.
You know, it just doesn't work sometimes. And you get input from people because you've got it your own.
Remember, we used to have these reports. The peas were hard. You know, every.
Yeah. Well, at one time they were seriously considering the fact that some, I guess, the Midwest especially, they had a lot of. These operations who were getting foods from a corporation, frozen, bring them in, thaw them out, send them out, send some out frozen. And Highland Valley was wondering whether it was still worth the effort to actually cook their own. Mm-hmm. And we finally concluded it was.
Yeah.
Because you had quality control, like you say, you have portion control, you have control over little extras.
Right.
No. Good.
No, I mean, Alan's really done a great job, and it's really, the board is really working hard.
Yeah. Any other questions for Kathy? No? Okay, we'll move on to new business. Committee reports. Would you like to handle that?
Sure. What, do you want to give an update on our space committee? That's a surprise. If you don't want to, you can throw it right back to me.
We met 3 weeks ago, so I don't think we've done a heck of a lot.
We're going to be meeting next week.
We're meeting next week, Victoria and Linda and I. I think we're ready to start ordering some new tables to reconfigure this room.
Jim, you have a comment on that?
I'm on the board now at the Elks. Okay, and I went through yesterday and found 60 grants that we'd be able to get. And some of them are considered furniture for senior housing and senior things. So before you do that, give me about a week and I'll research those grants for you.
Well, we're going to actually design hopefully a strategy next week of, you know, we went through it all, like, you know, 1, 2, 3. So we'll kind of prioritize the easy stuff to take care of so that will still affect the flow of our activity. So, you know, it'll happen. But it just didn't happen as quickly, as timely as we wanted. But there'll be something to report next month on that one.
After all, this year we will be 10 years in this building.
Yep.
And we haven't really changed except for the fitness center. We haven't changed the function of anything. Everything's pretty much where it was put into then. Some have expanded and overfilling their rooms, and some are not that expanded and they're using a big room for small people. So that's a lot of considerations.
I never thought about it like that, actually, 10 years and it hasn't.
No, everything that's in a room was in the room 10 years ago, with the exception of the fitness center. That's the only thing we've really changed.
It would seem to me that if we put new furniture and stuff around and have 10 years, we ought to have a party. Not like a party, but it seems like this would be one of the things that would bring people back into the senior center.
That's a great idea, 10th anniversary party.
You got it, you know, something that's over the top.
Yeah, I think that's a great idea.
Yeah.
You won't believe, I just wrote that down.
We could do it as a fundraiser too.
Yeah.
We do it as a fundraiser. Just, you know, have a table with people or whatever.
We'll have our book sale.
Oh, I know, like envelopes, you know, people want to donate.
No, I don't.
I got the census today. I imagine most of you have already got the mail today. And the envelope for the senior center is in there.
Yep.
Oh, that's a story.
And I found out that Susan's the household. I don't know how that happened. I'm not sure how that happened. I can't send her a form, but it's Susie's, it's mailed to, and it's to Susie's wife. The household of Susie's wife. Okay.
Okay. So we'll see what happens. I think last year it brought in $8,000, so that was wonderful. Mm-hmm. Yeah, it was a great, easy fundraiser. But yeah, I think, you know, your thoughts about a 10th anniversary, where we talked about something like that at the staff meetings too. And I, you know, we should form a committee and start thinking about what it's going to look like.
Mm-hmm.
I'm excited.
It's been 10 years, the building's still listening.
It's in good shape.
Does anybody remember when it actually opened? Like September?
September. September. It was the second Saturday in September.
Probably.
Because I had just come back from overseas.
Okay.
Because that would have been the second Saturday in September.
So if we wait until after the health fair, we can, that'll
yep.
be.
Yep. Yeah. That would be great.
We'll start going on that one.
Yeah.
You mentioned furniture. Do the rug first. The whole
the big rug out there?
Yeah, the whole shoot room. Or you can do the floor in the.
Yeah, the activity room floor, you're right.
That really needs work.
The senior center? I mean, the fitness center?
No. The next room over.
The problem with that one is it's so hard to even get in that room.
I know.
And if you cancel any programs, you know how delighted people are.
Well, I mean, once a while, construction has to be put.
Really, that is. I know it's overused, but, you know, we should.
At some point, you have to just say the room's closed for a week for renovations. I mean, it's as simple as that.
Yeah.
Give people enough notice.
They're going to like it.
And they can plan. Enough notice. And
nobody's going to die.
Right, exactly.
Bring the room for a week.
Even if you did, you just cancel it and not try to make a lot of work for yourselves. Just give them, you know, 6 weeks' notice and say the room's going to be closed for this week. It's simple as that. That's it.
Yeah.
Otherwise, you're moving, you know, it's...
Well, that's part of the problem with the room use.
Right, that's why I said you just got to close them down once at one at a time and just...
Tetris.
You know,
They don't make a particular mistake.
But enough notice, people won't deal with it.
Bob presented that the other day. He really loves his shiny floors, so, you know, he gets very upset about that room, so we'll have to get on, we'll get on Bob.
Okay, any questions regarding all this? No? Move on to age-friendly cities.
Okay, Cindy Langley, who was the director a couple, two directors ago, long directors ago, who is still working in AARP, would like in Washington, but she lives in Northampton.
Really?
She commutes once a month to Washington, or she goes to do things in other parts of the country. Has offered to be have a lead role in creating an age-friendly city.
Great.
So she and I are going to probably go to AARP in Boston in the next couple weeks to see how they can help us get going in that direction.
Great.
And I know Deborah Epstein, who is one of our new members, who has given her apology. She might be coming late, but it's going to almost be over. But she had an appointment today. She's also interested in being a part of that. The other thing is that it seems to go hand in hand, the age-friendly cities and the dementia-friendly cities. And I would really like Kathy to help us in that direction. Kathy and I had a talk the other day, and that the virtual tour that I participated in the conference at the Cape for the Massachusetts Council on Aging conference, and it was really exceptional.
Yeah.
Really, really exceptional.
I've never done it, but I've heard and seen it.
Yeah.
It's amazing.
Yeah.
You know, you just don't get it until you've kind of done something like that.
Aren't taking care of one.
Yes.
My husband.
Yeah, so you know, exactly.
So, you know, I mean, I know that that we have all sorts of suggestions and, like, you know, bring new members in, bring people, minorities in, you know, make our population more diverse. And but I also think that we really should focus it in, again, on people with dementia or the caregivers that need that support, too.
You know, I always tell, when I do a lot of training around dementia care, and I always tell, you know, the caregivers or people attending, people think there's no treatment. And what I say to people is that you are the treatment. You're really, I mean, meds and stuff like that, you're the treatment. So the other thing that I've heard other people say is the oxygen therapy. You need to put your own oxygen mask on before helping others. So you need to take care of yourself, as you probably know.
Right.
You guys, before you start caring for, you know, your loved one. So
I mean, I want to extend those really exciting activities, but I also want to really focus in on all of the the different cohorts and the needs of each of those cohorts as we design our strategies for next year. So thank you, Kathy.
Okay.
I
love it. So.
I mean, your background is exceptional in that area too, so thank you. Okay.
Any questions on the age-friendly cities? Okay, move on to elder.
Okay, anybody want to be a treasurer or elder mission? We still need the treasurer, so do you want to give an update?
Well, elder mission, we probably have a little over $20,000 in the funds. A lot of that came in from the tires campaign, but the senior center already has sufficient funds for the van drivers and others and extra. So we may use this for other things or other related. You may need to use some of the driver's training or something if you need.
Mm-hmm. With that specific focus, transportation.
Yeah, transportation basically on there, because that's where most of the money came in. We are having trips and travels go through Elder Vision now. Mm-hmm. People paying the travel agent. The travel agent is collecting everything, and when he gets all through, he gives the money to Elder Vision Inc. Mm-hmm. Because we're a 501c3.
That's good.
And then we pass it on to the senior center. Mm-hmm. So we actually just fund them for that.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
But we're maintaining Elder Vision primarily at the moment because we are a 501c3.
Yeah.
And there are a lot of grants you get that will not give money to a city department. Because you give a grant to a city department, the city can decide what they're going to do with it.
Yeah.
There's no protection.
Right.
I know the Arts Council has the same thing, they have an ink and stuff, just because of that, you know, in terms of doing all the hard work around, nothing against it, but it's really important, I think.
So we're in the process of, we've had three new members, we've lost two, probably a third. Oh, Boston announced right now that Mike Ahern has resigned from the board. And I think before the next meeting, I'll let you get a nice letter in appreciation of his many years. I don't know if the new people here are aware, but he has a tree in the back. And by Mary's garden, there's a tree planted there near the bicycle rack. I don't know, did he ever get a plaque for that?
I don't know.
I haven't checked. She was gonna get a plaque for it, it's, we dedicated it to Mike Ahern, we had the mayor down, we had Mayor Higgins, ex-Mayor Higgins down, and several other people. Mary Ford was here, and we dedicated it a couple of years ago, so.
So do we need new vice president? Was any vice president?
Yeah, so we're gonna need no vice president, but our election in May, we gather candidates. In June, we have our yearly meeting and we elect. So it's so close, I'm not sure, it's worth the effort at the moment. And we found out that Kathy can take over when somebody has an elder, who's an elder moment. Forget where he is.
It's hard filling your shoes.
Yeah, well, I know. You just have to talk a lot, that's all. And be nice enough.
I do that pretty well, Jim knows me at the coffee shop.
You just have to be loud enough, the other end of the table can hear me. So that's basically what Elder Vision is kind of in a transition right now. Jim is a new member. Yes?
I have a question in terms of the money, and I don't know how much, I know with, in the Arts Council, you know, you can put some money in a high interest loan, you know, and some kind of a fundraising, you know, a fund of money that you can just kind of have earn money.
Yeah.
We do that with our ink.
I'm not sure exactly how Debbie has it set up now, I think it's all bank accounts.
Okay.
But I will be contacting Debbie and taking over the treasurership temporarily until we can find somebody to volunteer to be the treasurer. So I'll be president and treasurer. I can already sign checks. I was assistant treasurer at one time, and Debbie signed me up for the check account, so.
Of course, the only monthly expense is Bob.
Bi-monthly, every other month. I have to write myself a check and sign it.
We'll see about that.
That's another thing that we may bring up in the Elder Vision meeting. At one time, of course, Elder Vision Inc. got the money for the Elder Vision newspaper. That's been taken away and solely in senior services now. But Elder Vision Inc. is still paying for the delivery of those, which, by the way, is cheaper than mail. I cost 12 cents a copy.
Okay.
12 cents a paper to deliver. I got the post office beat. But so we may be talking that over. I don't know why we're still paying for the delivery of something we have nothing to do with anymore. It does seem strange.
Yes.
So we may bounce that to the Crown Tree Chronicle and click on them in the future. And by the way, I don't get paid for my time. I get paid for the use of my car. The mileage use of my car. I can't get paid for anything I do around here anyway, because I'm a city retiree. And the city retirement board says I cannot receive any money from a municipal, state, or federal government funded organization without their express permission.
Yeah, no, I'm being asked to go back and work for the state, so all the amount of paperwork and stuff.
Yeah, you have to go through all that. So I was hoping one time to be one of the drivers, because I used to drive. I was the only one who drove a van for 10 years. But I can't get paid for it, so. Mm-hmm. I did offer to Jen that I will be a volunteer backup driver.
Mm-hmm.
So if you have a problem, I can still drive.
Even on a part-time basis, you can't do that, huh?
I can't go to my for my time. And Lord, without the information, I could go to the board, to the retirement board, and ask them. I say yes, but that is not with the effort.
We do have two people that fit that category as building monitors that work for the city. And they get their hourly rate, but it's only very minimal.
Yeah, I've received money from the building monitor too, and I'm not sure where that comes in, so. But then I never ask anybody, so if you don't ask questions.
Don't ask.
I shut the camera off. Okay, that's any other questions about Elder Vision? Thank you. Okay. We have a maximum of 7. We now have 5. I'm assuming that Mike Ahern will also be retiring.
Resigning
from that one. Yeah, I haven't heard from him yet, but I'm assuming he will.
Yeah.
And so we have three new ones and two older ones, myself and Glyffy.
Glyffy,
huh? I can say her name, but I never got that one out right. I can just sit there and stare at it. So that's why we're meeting today at 3:00. We're meeting afterwards because two of our members on the board have to be members of this board. That's by our bylaws. And Jim and I are members of the board. So that covers that right there.
Good.
So we're all set. Okay, any other questions? Okay, let's move on to discussion of an article in the last Chronicle. Barbara, I believe you have something to say.
Yeah. Two people approached me and I says, come to the public here, forum. Mm-hmm. They didn't want to do it. This citizen's turnout for women's marriage, they considered it political. If you look closely, you will see Trump's picture in the background.
Oh, yeah.
Yep. Yeah. Do you?
Right here.
Oh, on a poster.
Right there.
See, I just read it as her opinion.
Yeah. Yeah.
That's the story I got. So,
I would call this a human interest article written in the first person.
Right.
So, and I read it thoroughly today with that in mind, looking for political. And yes, it's about an older woman marching for her own personal rights. I don't see, I don't see how come we can't cover things like that.
I would assume there's probably some people who marched who were directly doing this to spit in Donald's face. But that was a personal, secondary agenda. That was not the agenda of the march, nor the purpose of the march.
But they brought it up to me, so
And that's why we have to discuss it, and we have to, think what's right and what's wrong.
And we have read the article, several times to make sure we know what we're talking about. So it was good it was brought up.
Yeah.
So
I don't think she was pushing anything in particular. I was looking for her. She didn't say nasty things or, advocate one thing or another. We know what the march was for. I mean, that's why hundreds of women were doing that, thousands. But I don't see it as a problem.
No, so, I don't either.
Do we have to respond to these people? Do we have to respond to these people?
Do I have to respond?
Do we as a board have to respond back, or we just
no?
If they came as a
public, it's a public thing, that would be different
things coming through.
But it's also an interesting conversation to have in terms of understanding. I don't know of an article about just people's concerns and understanding.
Well, it shows somebody's reading the paper.
And we also know they're listening to the broadcast, too, because Jim had that one up. The time we gave the editor two free
right.
He immediately had two people talk to him and say, how many volunteer hours do you have to get a free
Center? Oh, yeah.
And that's how we brought it up and decided that we're not something we're going to do. But people do watch these things and people we know. And Barbara, anytime somebody comes to you with something, bring it up.
I think it's important to have the conversation. People need to be able to be heard.
And we may miss something. Yeah.
I mean, we don't want to do anything that will offend anyone. And I said, I better read this over again if it offended someone. And I really couldn't see that what I saw her story.
Yeah.
And I know when Lou, I said the one thing we can't do is we cannot, make political comments and political statements. We can't do that, and I have to, be very. And when I read it, it was like I couldn't feel that it was a political statement. She could have made it a really big political statement. A couple paragraphs of why she's
then it wouldn't have got published.
Right. That's right.
And then it wouldn't have gotten published. Exactly.
And like I say, I'm sure there were some people there who that was their only purpose, but I think they were the vast minority and not represented in that article, particularly.
Whoever accepted this as an article, I think did a fine job. Whoever's policing this.
Editing and stuff.
Yeah.
Well, Lou, basically.
But so if people are, for some of us or other people, like Barbara, we could just say, what response do we have for things, for those kinds of things? People come and complain, we should just refer on to,
I think she did the right thing.
So we can just say we'll bring it up to a board meeting.
They weren't interested, once in a business and...
That's okay. And lots of people like to complain to us but don't want to come and say it in first person to us, so...
But we have a public session, we have rules for the public session, which is you get 5 or 10 minutes, there's a lot of people, 5 minutes. And you speak your piece, you don't interact with the board, and the board doesn't interact with you. The same rules that the city council does. And then we can discuss it amongst ourselves afterwards, of course. And, but anytime there's anybody has somebody to bring a problem up, and you can't get a good answer off your head, bring it in here.
Yeah, right.
Doesn't mean they're wrong, doesn't mean they're right, it means it should be addressed. And it's addressed. I don't know if they like what the result has been, but I don't know if you do either, but I think we've addressed it at least, to the point.
Well, I think the point that we made, you know, the staff talks about these things in our little hallway meetings. If someone had written a first-person story about being part of the inauguration, or one of those events, that would have been considered a story we might publish as well. So there's no specific political slant or anything like that going on, and that is the...
I mean, I'm sure a lot of people went to the inauguration and didn't agree with Trump, but they go to the inauguration because it is a big event. So, you know, just going or being there doesn't, is an event.
Even if you do, you write it as such in a neutral tone.
And I think she did.
Neutral writing.
Very neutral.
Yeah.
Okay, Barbara, I hope...
Are you okay?
If you please tell us beforehand, try to explain to them.
Right.
And tell them if they want to, they can come back next time, and we have a public session, we'll listen.
Okay.
She could do it by letter too, couldn't she?
Yeah.
You could, yes.
No, I know these people, so I'll just talk to them.
But you can, you know, from my perspective, and I think from the board's, we won't get political, you know, in the true sense of the word, you know. If we wouldn't have put 2 paragraphs of, you know, our discontent with the government or anything like that, that's not going to be part of our publications. This was a woman's journey in the first person, like you were saying. So it's maybe a fine line, but I don't think it's crossed over the line.
But we do have a policy of not being political, outright political. And I think it's going to be costly. In election year, we bend over even further backwards. In election year, we don't want to be seen to be supporting any candidates. So it's even tougher then.
So there's a big issue coming right now, the healthcare changeover. We might have people that want to tell senior citizens what they can do. How are we going to address that? That's a big political issue, and AARP just came out against the...
I think the only thing that would be really fair would be to explain what the health bill is and let people make up their mind on that. Just explain what it is.
That could be coming down the pipe, some of the stories.
Because you can read some of this legislation, you can't understand it. But if somebody translates it and says this is what it's going to do, then you can make up your own mind, I like that or I don't like that. But to actually give an opinion on it, I think we would probably...
What I think is exactly what you're saying is how we have to give all of the steps, because I mean, I'm sorry, but this is the health and welfare of our population. And you know, we don't have to take a political stance, but we have to say, you know, if this is what is going to be missing in your benefit package, if this is approved.
Yeah. These are the changes that they're going
to... We're not telling people to call, but you've got to educate. I mean, you know, this could be a life-death situation. How can we...
Doesn't it depend on your individual situation, though? I just heard you say is that this is, if this happens, all of these things are going to be missing in your health care. I don't know if that's universal. I think that's just only if you fall into this category or this category.
But then you put those categories in there.
That's why I say an explanation of what it is doing and what it's not going to do would be more valuable than an opinion.
You know, I would think that we'd run it through Mark before we get anything.
Mark, okay? If we...
Just wait a moment.
Do they need to talk about what we have the resources so you can get information.
Right, exactly.
And you can get your questions answered.
Yeah.
Social worker.
Especially Michelle and our Shine workers.
Yeah, Shine.
And these are people you make appointments with to see how it's going to affect you.
But it hasn't been decided yet.
No.
And it probably won't be decided for a long time.
But when and if it comes in, that would be our role, would be to advise people. You have people that can sit back in your situation and say, this is what happened, this is what happened.
But we couldn't put in this paper a call to action to get, you know.
Right, exactly.
It's being said by AARP that it's going to negatively affect senior citizens greatly. So we're not allowed to put that in here and say, you know.
Not yet, no. Only if it passes, then we can say what it actually does.
We're not an advocate agency.
We can do a comparison.
Yeah.
What's your feeling, Mark?
I would have to see what you're trying to put in there.
Okay.
Yeah. Say something about it there. You're not taking a position on something. If you say, you know, we're against this bill or we're for this bill, then you're taking a political position.
Yeah.
But if you're saying, this is a bill that's been proposed, this is what it does, if you can somehow be neutral about it and say, this is what we understand this bill.
Doesn't.
Yeah, I think that could work. Like, you know, this is what your, these are the benefit packages with, you know, under, that you're receiving, and that if this bill goes through, this is how it will affect your benefit package. I mean, I think we have to educate, but I think it's, the wording's important. I think that people have to know. But, you know, the bottom line is that, you know, this is Massachusetts, you know, and, you know, our state senators are going to be, you know, voting not for to maintain the status quo, basically. I don't think we have the lobbying, but I think the education's important.
I think we're probably going to need to wait until something actually is proposed.
Well, I also wonder if you had either McGovern or Elizabeth, one of the senators, comes out with an explanation that's generic enough. I don't know if you can even put that in.
Interesting.
That might be something that they say if they come up with something that's.
But an explanation would have to be an explanation without any prejudice or any pointing to it.
Yeah, right.
This is terrible, or this is good. Just this is what it does, this is what it doesn't do.
We have that
here used to do this, this one now does that.
Shine does that, actually. And Shine has been sending a number of notifications out, so you could just.
I think maybe it's not our place at the moment to do something on that.
I agree.
And then if it does pass, put in the paper, recommend people come in. If you are in doubt, you're confused, come in and make an appointment with one of our Shine or Michelle and find out in your safe, in your particular condition, what's going to happen. Because otherwise you could write a whole paper on all the various permutations and all the various possibilities.
It's hard. I mean, a lot of laws, it's like open to interpretation. I mean, it's complicated.
Oh, yeah. It is complicated.
Well, Obamacare is a complicated thing.
Yeah, I think people are thinking that Massachusetts is going to be kind of safe, but the way that I read it is they're going to give a block of money to each state, and that block of money will be a lot less than we get, like for Medicaid, for instance.
Medicaid won't change.
If they give you less money, yes, it will. Because if they give you a block of money that's less than what you were used to getting in Massachusetts, yes, it will change.
Then you're up to the state to make up the difference or not.
We haven't finished anything yet.
That's right, you haven't said
anything yet. We haven't finished it yet. So.
Well, they're trying to push it through, and even though they're not finished with it, they're trying to get it to be passed.
I mean, there's a lot of opposition, not only from Democrats, a lot of opposition from conservative Republicans on the current bill, which may stall it. Because they're going to need all the Republicans they can get it through. And if a block of them say, no, this isn't good enough, they're going to have to go back to the drawing board. So we may have several permutations in the state before you ever get anything that really is seriously on the floor. So.
Yeah, it's really interesting who's opposing it, the liberals and the really conservative people. Because the really conservative people think it's too much, and the liberals don't think it's enough.
Yeah.
So it's like interesting that those two ends are agreeing to not agree.
And that part we can't present, you know.
Yeah, right.
And you know, I'll bring it. If anything looks like a red flag, I'll bring it to the board here to review.
Okay. It's good to be cautious.
Yeah.
We can't be silent necessarily on everything, but it's good to be cautious. and proceed. Okay, any other questions on that matter? Okay.
We'll say this about the Chronicle. When I run into people downtown, everybody is tickled to death with it.
Oh, yeah.
I mean, everything's been positive.
Yeah.
And I think that the people that are really doing a good job.
Our new editor and the people running on, they're running the Chronicle right now are doing a very good job.
When's the new one coming out? The big one?
I just delivered the big one, so March, well, May.
May.
The insert will be in April, for the Gazette insert, the four-page insert.
No, I'm talking the one that looks like the Hampshire Light.
Yeah, that's coming out every other month, so it's coming out in May.
March was one of those.
That's March, April, May, every other month.
So that is the big one.
Yeah. So May will be the next large one, and April will be the insert.
And we're, just to go on a little bit, we're working on making sure that everyone over 60 years of age receives one in the mail. And we've got a tax write-off person who's going through, you know, doing a comparison between the streets and, you know, and our mailing list. So, you know, it's coming. And then we're also offering options for people who don't mind get their copies online because it's a cost savings. And I have to say, again, I can't say how good our staff is, but Victoria, and I call her Veronica, you can just yell at me, oh my God. Victoria has identified the fact that we have been paying bulk rate, you know, from the Gazette, while we should be paying a nonprofit status for bulk mailing. So that should continue, that should significantly reduce some of our expenses for the paper. Because it is an expensive proposition. But she and another tax write-off person and a couple of tax write-off people are going to,
I'm sorry to interrupt, hello. I need to take the van to be inspected for 3 o'clock in Hatfield.
Oh, quick.
So can you take a couple minutes to come out now, or?
Yeah, I think we better.
All right, quick, gotta look at it.
You're driving around the parking lot.
How are you gonna get to Hatfield? Okay, that's Michelle's baby, but she's got all the invitations out to everyone, hopefully. And it's going to be May 11th, and that's the time, 10 to 2? 10 to 2. And I see, it's on Thursday.
And we need volunteers for serving public.
And what is this?
Health and Safety Fair, Thursday, May 11th. Okay.
John.
Heather, you need somebody to serve on that one?
I do.
Well, I'm there.
Me too. I'm kitchen.
She's kitchen.
I already have it down.
If Jim is in town, he'll probably help.
May 11th, yes, I'll help.
Okay.
And who else?
Yeah, check his schedule there quickly.
Yeah, we're trying to figure out going.
Oh, if I need to do coffee shop.
You'll have to do coffee shop, so. Well, that was easy, thank you.
I didn't get that first.
Barbara's gonna do a table.
In the afternoon, if you need people.
I'll do whatever.
At least don't let that happen.
Okay, we've, might move on to volunteer recognition.
It's a Heather.
Heather again?
Volunteer recognition this year will be on Monday, April 24th, from 11:30 to 1:30. So invitations will be going out hopefully next week, actually. It's that time again. I know, it feels like we just did.
Just did that. What's the base criteria, or hours?
It's 25 hours. So that's one of the reasons you should be scanning in and recording your hours. So I can just print out the report and not go, oh, Mary never recorded her hours, but I know that she volunteered 500 this year, so.
You say 11 to 1?
11:30 to 1:30. Seth Myers is gonna do the catering.
Oh, great.
We should have an invitation out in the mail shortly. But most of you, just by coming to the board meetings and volunteering at some of the events, will hit 25, so.
What day is it?
So this is kind of sensitive for me. Last year I didn't attend because.
April 24.
It was nothing for me to eat there, and it was put that I could bring my own food, which I felt kind of offended by that. So I don't know if there could be some, you know, some leeway, because it felt like it wasn't recognizing me if I came and brought my own food. So, you know, I mean, I understand you can't do it for everybody, but, you know, that would be right away not.
If you ask Seth, I'm sure.
Yeah, I was going to say, I was going to ask Seth about.
Like a vegetable lasagna or something like that?
Yeah.
Is that? Yeah, I mean, something, some.
Actually, most of us who eat meat, we eat, and I had this vegetarian, we'll eat vegetarian food, I loved it, as a side dish.
I haven't even chosen a menu yet, so you're all a step ahead of me, but I am going to talk to Seth, and I can mention that there's, you know, I know we have gluten-free and food allergies and vegetarian, all kinds of different food things.
Yeah.
And he deals with it much more than I do, so I'm sure we'll be able to.
And he's got a new place up in the beach up in Rhode Island.
I will bring you a meal if you just order. You will be fed.
It may only be one.
Yeah, we'll see. But I'll keep that in mind as I'm planning.
Thank you.
Yeah.
I'm not going to totally, I'm no way I'm going to exclude the one person that stood with me in 0-degree weather in that beautiful, what, stroll, you know, but, and we were frozen, and she was there with me, and I'll, you know, I'll bring you the meal if Seth can't.
Seth, he'll take care of it very nicely.
He's wonderful, and I'm sure that will.
Very nicely.
No.
And I'm sure you're not the only one who would like something like that.
Right, right.
So if ever signed this dish is vegetarian, this dish is vegetarian, I'm sure there'd be plenty of people.
Heather, can I ask you a question? I'm sorry. Is there a response on the invitation? Do you have to call? You have to call and respond.
I don't even have invitations yet, so.
No, but if you're asked, you've got to call and respond.
They are on our RSVP.
It probably should be, because you got a plane meeting, so Seth has to.
That's a project for next week, so just put the dates on your calendars, and the rest will all come together.
Oh, we don't want to overburden Heather.
I'm finally getting out from under the piles.
Yeah, that's right. She's finally breathing again.
Did you, are there any times about the training?
Oh, yes, I was going to.
That was my other term.
So the cool thing that happened this week was that the city has done some emergency planning. So things like if there's an active shooter or a fire, what are we supposed to be doing? We never have those plans in place. Yes, run.
That's what we do at the hospital. You've got your code silver and, you know, it's an active shooter.
Well, the hospital has this wonderful plan for anything in the world that happens. We never had that. So a couple of us went to the training on Monday and learned all the stuff. And then
what training was that?
You could incorporate that as the volunteer.
That's what I want to do.
And when is that going to be?
I'm looking at Tuesday, April 18th from 4:30 to 5:30. That seems like it will work for a lot of people.
That's it.
4:30 to 5:30?
Yeah, 4:30 to 6.
I don't know.
I'm here.
We have to go over the manual. We have to finish the manual.
We'll just say 4:30 on until you finish.
Yeah.
We'll pull you 5:30 to 6.
I'm not sure. I think it's pretty basic information, but it's just making sure we all know it.
That's Tuesday, April 18th, right?
Yeah.
Yes.
I will put that down.
Is that a time of day that works for most people?
I have no problem with it.
April 18th. No, actually, that doesn't work for me on Tuesday. But do it without me.
Doesn't work for me either.
Tuesday's tough for me. I have a standing meeting from 3 to 5.
Does it work for anybody?
Yeah, it works for me.
Works for me.
Okay. So, and we'll just, now that it's coming together, we'll just do it over and over?
Yeah.
Yeah.
Okay, so there will be a second chance to do that?
Yeah.
Possibly in the month of May?
And I'm thinking once we have it together, as we're adding volunteers, it might be a month-to-month ongoing thing.
Right.
Yeah.
But I want to test it out on some seasoned people.
So many things, right?
Like you.
Not a good idea.
Any other day?
Yeah, I'll use it, no problem.
Any other day?
No, stagger it. I'll probably do mornings and afternoons.
Anything but Tuesday.
I'm never going to make everybody happy.
Okay, any questions on the training? Okay, recognition. Do I have a motion to adjourn?
No, I have one other thing.
One question, sir.
One more thing.
One more thing.
The Sunday at 5 o'clock, at the
Blue Goose Room.
The Blue Goose Room, very good. Four of our senior center people who have written books are having a reading, and everybody's all excited about it.
Where's that?
It's at the old bar, what's it called?
The platform.
The platform bar, yeah.
Oh.
That's a special room that's affiliated with the platform.
Yep.
When is it again?
4:00.
What day again?
This Sunday.
This Sunday.
The time, but he just said.
4:00.
Oh, remember, change of clocks, so.
I thought he said 5, but it was.
I said 5.
He said 5. It's 4:00 now.
Okay.
So I get 3?
No. But I'm pretty proud of the folks that are reading, you know, they're actually.
It's at the Blackhawk Bar, the Union State, the old Union State.
Oh.
Union State, yeah. I guess you have that back room there.
Their writer, their instructor, thank you.
Yeah.
Good work, great.
Valuable asset.
Not to go in depth or anything, but is anything new about how much longer the club's gonna be using the kitchen?
It was supposed to be until March. They said 3 months, and our last meeting, they said 3 months more.
3 months more, so.
March, and March.
Have they been better taking care of the equipment?
John's been looking.
It's a fair middle end.
Yeah.
It was, we pulled out some pans today, yesterday, to make my corned beef, and they were all greasy and dirty. My wife washed them all before.
Do you talk to them?
A couple of times, I found the grease trap, I did the stove not clean. I've shown some people that were in the kitchen that cleaned. So it's okay.
But it could be better.
Yeah.
Well, considering they're getting the favor here, I think they should do better.
Especially for free.
Okay, now.
I'll make a motion to close the meeting.
Second.
Second over here. All those in favor?
Aye.
Anybody opposed?
Come on, say what you're doing.